I remember one time I called one of my members to preach for the first time in the church. And when he arose and he looked at the congregation, he looked at me and he told me, and the congregation, ladies and gentlemen, I feel like I have a generator in my belly. I'm so fearful to stand and speak. I don't know what I'll do. I need your prayers. I'm equally so humble to have such a moment where we have our daddy, our mentor, sitting and listening to what he has invested in us. We really thank God for him. If you don't mind, you can celebrate with me. Luke chapter number 22, we are looking from verse number 31. Luke chapter 22, verse number 31. The Bible says, and this is the address of Jesus Christ. The Bible says, Jesus spoke to this wonderful guy, and he said, and the Lord said, Simon, Simon, indeed Satan has asked for you, that he may do what? He may sift you as wheat. Verse number 32. But what has happened? But I pray for you that your faith should not fail. And when you have returned to me, strengthen your brethren. Praise the name of the Lord. Help us to learn this morning on security steps during your times of safety. Understanding security steps during your times of safety. Because all of us, we will go through moments of crisis. All of us will have moments that are not easy, times that everything cannot be gathered to be understood. There is no way you live in this earth without your season of adversity. There will be a day of adversity that will come and befall your life. The question is, what will happen during that time? And I want you to know, times of sitting are moments of crisis, moments that are of great danger, difficulty, terror, and at such a times it prompts important decisions to be made that will either break you or take you out of it. Because during those times, people have options of what they are supposed to do. And it is inevitable that moments of sifting and crisis will befall all of us. It is only a matter of when shall you go through yours. All of us will have times that will be so confusing, so hard. And most of the time, this crisis can be in waiting, hanging over you, or hanging over your place, and it's waiting for a season to explode on your life. And so when that time comes, it just begins, either because of the past actions of whatsoever people that were in that place. You remember in the book of Joshua, chapter number 6, verse 26, after Joshua took over Jericho, the Bible says he spoke a statement over the land. And he said, whomsoever rises to build you Jericho shall do the foundation at the death of his firstborn. And if he ever finishes you, he will do it at the death of his lastborn. In other words, there is a statement hanging, waiting to explode in that place. And you remember in the book of 1 Kings chapter 16, a very innocent man comes to the place and feels like, why is this city not built? And he begins to reconstruct it and build it. And what happens? A crisis befalls. Something begins to happen. When he lays the foundation, the firstborn dies. And when he finishes, the lastborn dies. It means a crisis can be waiting in a place. It can be hanging over your region, over your city, over your village, and you are very innocent. You have just bought land in that place, and you are building up a home and you don't understand what befalls that place. You don't understand. That's why we encourage you, before you settle, before you build, before you do something, please put in place, consider to be able to dedicate the place. Because you don't understand what civilization was there before you came there. And so don't behave as if you really know anything. Because there are some places that are hanging with a calamity that is waiting to explode to a person that will fulfill what you are doing in that place. Can someone say amen? And so I want you to know that crisis can be hanging over the place, and you are innocent, and you are coming in that place, you don't know what has happened. It may be also generational. You know, your predecessors did some things, and they exposed you by virtue of being a member of that genealogy. For example, you remember the family of Ahab and Jezebel. They lived long lives. And so what happened? The judgment was transferred to the next generation. They said to Solomon, he messed up his life and his relationship with God. And when he humbled, the judgment was taken to the next generation. And Rehoboam took the judgment that was the father's. And so you can be a member of a genealogy, and that genealogy is having a crisis in waiting. It is, there's something that is hanging in that place and you don't know anything. You remember in the Bible, in 2 Samuel chapter number 21, when David comes to the throne and he takes over the seat, he doesn't know that the throne he's taking has a crisis in waiting. Because the predecessor Saul had killed the Gibeonites. He had messed up the life of the people. He had made a covenant that he will never kill. And so what happens? David takes over, a man after God's own heart, a man that loves God. He takes over the seat. And when he comes to the place, he is not aware that the seat has a crisis in waiting. And so when he takes over the seat, what happens? There is famine on the land for 3 consecutive years. There is a crisis going on. And David goes before God and says, God, what is happening? I am a man after your own heart. I mean, it's written, when the righteous take authority, the land is to have peace. The land is to enjoy. But we are not experiencing this thing. What has happened? And God tells him, it's not about you, David. It's because of the predecessor. The man that went before you, he killed the Gibeonites, and there has been a crisis in waiting on that throne. You can see that all of us, in one way or the other, not necessarily you are making, even the place you arrive may be having a hanging crisis. And so you need to know, in one way or the other, we shall go through a crisis. Because it is not necessarily you are making, it may be made by events beyond your life. Someone can say amen. And so because of that, you need to understand that I've seen this as I've lived, as I've walked lives of men, that our lives and lives of men are either destroyed or decorated by the experiences they survive. If you look at anyone, people look like their experiences. Come here, look at your neighbor. Tell your neighbor, your face tells you what you have gone through. Can someone say amen? Your face tells me what you have gone through. People look like what they have gone through. And how you have gone through reveals the outcome of your life. My teacher taught me in class that people's lives are 10% of what people have done to them, and 90% of how they have reacted to what people have done to them. You look like how you have reacted to what people did to you. That's what your life shall become. That's what people shall be seeing. Because when we go through a crisis, we develop some mechanism of protection so that we don't go through it again. And it becomes our character. It becomes our lifestyle. I need to know that as we look at this, security steps, because I want you to know we are sharing this because many people have fallen prey of how to handle their times of crisis. They don't know how to go about it. They don't understand what to do. And that's why this morning the Lord feels it wise to empower us to know that crisis will come or we must survive. If you hear me, can you say amen? When crisis comes, we must survive. We must have a mentality of a survivor. Somebody that knows, I know I shall go through it, but I shall not die in it, because my life shall not be destroyed in it, but should be decorated by it. You can be decorated by your crisis. You can turn the crisis into triumph. You can turn the crisis into victory. You can become a testimony by the way you handle your crisis. And you can become an encouragement by the way you handle your crisis. No wonder the Bible says, in the scripture we have read, Jesus is telling Peter, I saw Satan desiring to sift you like wheat, but I pray for you not to escape, but that when you have gone through it, you may encourage your brothers. Ladies and gentlemen, that crisis is not there to kill you. It's not there to destroy your future. There is something being made in your life. There is some glory being prepared. There is something you are being encouraged, so that when you come out of it, you are an instrument of inspiration. You are an instrument of encouragement. You are a son and daughter of encouragement. Somebody say amen. Come on, somebody, if you hear me, can you say, I hear you? How do you know this? That all of us, as we look like, is because of how we have reacted, how we have handled our crisis. And you need to know that it's important for you to survive your crisis. When you survive your crisis, what I mean by survive, it means you continue to live on in the face of the danger. You purpose, even though this has happened, but I know I shall still live on. I know my life has not entered into this that has happened. I know as long as my Redeemer is left, I shall continue to live. I know my Redeemer is alive, and that he shall appear in my situation. He shall appear in my eye. Are you getting me, my friends? Help me to know that you have a Redeemer. That's why you come to church. You have a Redeemer. You are not like the people of the world. You have a Redeemer. He cares for you. He loves you. But he wants you to survive the crisis, because he knows when you survive, he will encourage your brothers. He will encourage others. And that's why he has allowed you to understand this. But to survive, it means he will continue to live on even in the face of adventure. To survive, it means you shall endure in the midst of that. He will not allow it to kill you. He will not backslide. He will not quit the church. He will not run away from that marriage, because that event is seasonal. It's not there forever. Paul writes in 2 Corinthians chapter number 4 from verse number 16 and 17, he says, though our outward man is perishing, but our inner man is being renewed day by day. And then he says, because of the temporary afflictions. He says they are temporary, those afflictions. But crisis is just but temporary. He says, when whatsoever you're going through is not forever, it will not be there forever. So don't make decisions that are emotional in a temporary event. Because that's what many people do. When they go through a crisis, they make permanent decisions. I've seen people put their finger down on the ground and take the sword, and they begin to make a vow and say, me, I will never marry, because of the crisis they are going through that time. And they don't know their words will catch up with them. They are ensnared by their words. What do you speak during your crisis? What do you say during your crisis? What do you proclaim during your crisis? No wonder, if you look at the life of Job, the Bible says he was so careful. He didn't sin with his mouth. He did not utter, because he understands when you are in a crisis, your words matter. What you say matters. It will either take you out as a person decorated, or it will take you out as a person destroyed. And so you must understand how to go through this. So to survive means you endure. To survive also means that you conquer. You conquer that situation. You conquer what is happening. You move on. I've had people say, I am more actually overcomes obstacles. And conquer is somebody that goes beyond the obstacles that come in his life. And conquer is also a person that takes possession by force. So when you say you are a conqueror, it means you are you have a fighter spirit. You can fight out in the midst of that situation. You are not one that will backslide. The way Paul says, do not cast away your confidence in the Lord Jesus, because it has a great recompense. Because you need faith, you need patience, you need to hold on. Learn to be patient in the midst of that situation. Don't be quick in making decisions. Don't be quick in jumping on what to do. Have patience. You need patience. And then he says, we are not among them but draw back and backslide, but we are among them that stand still, because we know our Redeemer liveth. We know he shall come in the midst of our situation. This morning, the Lord has sent you to encourage somebody. I don't know what sifting moment you're going through. I don't know what situation is coming on your way. But the Lord is sending you to tell you, you can survive. I tell you, you will survive. You will not die in it. Your ministry shall not die in it. Your business shall not die in it. Your children shall not die in it. You shall survive. The Lord has sent me to tell you, you are not among them that are backsliding. You are not among them that are quitting ministry because of the crisis that is going on. But you shall stand still and know the Lord is calm. He will stand still and be always expectant of his coming in your situation. Somebody can you say amen? Ladies and gentlemen, the biblical prophecies indicate perilous times in the end times that are awaiting the children of God. And God expects us to put measures in place that will make us survive. God knows, you know, even in the natural world, when you are on the roads, before you go to the roads, they tell you, you need an insurance car. Because they know a crisis can strike at a time. And so, even in the natural, they want you to make some security step. They want you to put some measure so that when a crisis strikes, you are not destroyed. You can still stand and continue in life. They understand. And equally, God has given us the wisdom to know that we also need to have security steps that will make us survive what comes on our way. Are you getting me, my friends? All of us, although they are perilous times, God has given us promises. God has given us the word. The Bible says in Isaiah 59 verse 17, even when issues, when crisis comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord shall lift up a standard. Somebody say amen. The Spirit of the Lord shall do what? Shall lift up a standard. The Lord shall lift up a standard over all things. Can somebody say amen? And another version saying, when we go through the times of crisis, the Lord shall lift up standard bearers. In other words, even in that family, a standard bearer shall arise. You will not all die, but somebody shall stand to be a standard bearer. I declare you will be the standard bearer. The Lord will spare your life to be a standard bearer. The Lord will make you survive to be a standard bearer. This morning, I am speaking to survivors. Come on, I'm speaking to survivors. People that understand, I'm not just there, I'm not just saved, but I'm a remnant. I am a survivor. I'm born with the Lord in beginning a new dream in my family. Somebody say amen. Come on, can you look at the little? I am a survivor. God says, even in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, even as we go through all this, he will not take us beyond our ability. He will not take us through beyond what we can carry. Please, what you're going through, the Lord knows you will go through it. The Lord knows you will not die through it. You will not judge, you will go through it. And so you need to understand. He says, I shall make a door through which you shall escape. I declare this morning, may there be a door opened in his child. He takes care of you. He cares for your life. And so you will survive. Someone say, I will survive. Our God is a God of survivors. He is a God of survivors. He is a God of a remnant. He is a God that will spare somebody in the prevailing devastation so that he may begin a new chapter on that person's life. You are not just a survivor. You are a survivor of hope. A person that when people see, they see a new beginning. They see another chance. They see that, even though this has happened to our family, I know that our Redeemer shall again remember us. He shall come to us and make us go through it again. This morning, God has told me to speak to somebody who is a survivor. Come on, I speak to a remnant. Someone that understands, I am not just there. I am a remnant. I am a survivor. I am somebody that God has allowed to live in the midst of the devastation of my family. Someone say amen. Survivors. That's why David, who is a man after God's own heart, he says, the Bible says, when he came to the throne, he asked, is there anyone that has remained in the house of Saul? Even in the midst of the devastation, in the midst of what happened, David, who is a man after God's heart, he represents the heart of our God. He stands and says, is there anyone that has remained in the house of Saul, that I may show him kindness. I may show him kindness. God shows kindness to survivors. He shows kindness to somebody. That's why, even when your family looks like it has nobody, I want to tell you, you can become the somebody there. There is some remnant. There is a survivor. This morning, I know and I want to present you to know that our God has a nature of remembering survivors. Even in the midst of every devastation, there is a survivor that he will show kindness. And listen, God's kindness is not like human kindness. That's why when you look at that 2 Samuel chapter 9, you see the characteristics of God's kindness. Very unique. Number one, you see that God's kindness has a characteristic of locating. It locates. This young man, Mephibosheth, had been down so far from what he was to be. He had been so much secluded and thrown away that nobody could ever imagine he could be remembered. But when God's kindness came, the Bible says, he was located where he was. I declare, even you as a remnant, may the kindness of the Lord locate your life, locate you where they have thrown you. I don't know where the world has thrown you. I don't know where your family has blessed you. But listen to me, when the kindness of God strikes, you are located. I know even after this service, somebody shall be located.
Survive!
understand, that He has a plan for your life. Are you hearing me, somebody in the house? The kindness of God, number one, it locates. It follows you where you have been thrown. It follows you where people have written you off. It comes to the place. It is so unique and specific for you. And it comes to pick you from that place. But when it finds you, it relocates you. It takes you where you belong, where you can enjoy, where you can be fluential, where you can be celebrated, where you can be honored, where you can be done everything. It picks you from that place. Number three, the kindness of God, it restores. It restores. When God extends kindness to you, you are restored. I see David commanding Ziba and telling him from today, all that belonged to Saul, let it be taken back to Mephibosheth. From today, all that you have been enjoying is now being taken back to the owner. From today, I declare this morning, what people have been enjoying that belongs to you, all after this service, it's not restored to you. I declare, may you enter into a season of restoration. So that what people have been sitting on and enjoying, it shall be taken back to your life. This service is a service that the Lord is remembering a survivor, a remnant. Oh, somebody can you say amen? We serve a God of a remnant. That's why in Amos chapter 3 verse 12, the Bible says, as a shepherd takes out of the mouth of a lion a piece of a leg and a piece of an ear, so shall the Lord deliver them that are spread and scattered in the nations. You are a remnant. You are not just a person. You are a remnant. The Lord will always remember. You may not be whole. You may not be the way you are. But anyway, the Lord has found you. I know things happen. You are torn. There are things you lost in the process of the crisis. But listen to me. Even if you are remaining a piece of an ear, the Lord shall deliver your life. Even if you are remaining a piece of a leg, the Lord is able to bring you back. You are the hope of your generation. This moment I want to declare that please, our God is a God of survivors. He makes people survive. And that's why He says, even during the days of Job, you can see the crisis of Job. When people come to Job and they give their testimony and they say, Job, I was in this place and the Ishmaelites came and they took everything and they killed even the people we were. But bring a few, the report, I survived. In the midst of the destruction, somebody must survive. Somebody will tell the story. Somebody will say what will happen. He must survive. Can somebody say amen? I want you to know, as we will be looking, this is our part one. In the next section, we'll be looking at our part two of this message, in which I'll be looking now at the practical steps and security steps that you need to go through when you are going through that time of safety. Let me bow down our heads as we pray together in the name of Jesus Christ. We thank you and we bless you, Jehovah. We honor you because you are a God of survivors. You are a God that has ordained our lives that we may not die in the crisis that is prevailing. You have shown it even over our nation. But in the midst of every crisis, there may be a remnant. May be somebody that will start to tell the story. And we thank you because that's what you have made us to be, even in this generation. We are not just saved, we are survivors. We are a remnant. And that's why we come to the understanding that this grace is not just mere grace. It's grace that has made us to be survivors, to stand on our generation and declare your goodness in our days. I pray that Jehovah, you are opening our eyes that we may understand this truth. Thank you because you are our God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.